because we have worshiped the Lord.
Beautiful to the other person. As I've always told my kids growing up, it's just not the hour, but it's the whole
1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. It says, your adornment must not be merely external. Braid the hair, wearing gold, jewelry, or putting on dresses. But let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a meek. When we say meek, we're not talking about someone timid and afraid to speak. We're not talking about that. Because when I first read that word, I was like, God, help me because I'm a talker. I'm very out and about like Lisa.
What?
Not quiet, not the energizer one. But just outgoing talking. And over the years, I mean, people at church think I'm quiet.
Yes.
Because I've learned how to, what the definition of meek is. Yielding. Meek means, listen, yielding, obedient, compliant, humble, tame, and unresisting. Not just sitting there not talking. Meek is being yielded, obedient, compliant, humble, tame, unresisting. So, the person that thought just to sit there that you were meek, but yet you're in your spirit, you're fighting, in your spirit, you're resisting, in your spirit, you're not with the program, God see you. So just because you're sitting there quiet, I mean you me. But that's not mean you me.
Well, come on.
Amen. What we call that? Passive aggressive.
All
amen.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
And then it says a quiet spirit. A quiet spirit is peaceful, calm, and settled. A quiet, again, that means sitting there not talking. It doesn't mean not communicating your point. But a quiet spirit is a peaceful, calm, settled person. Have you all ever met someone, it's like they're very, you see, they're outgoing, they're talkative, but it's just this calm, calmness about them, this quiet confidence in them. Amen? So it's not because they sit there and they're quiet. So again, you can be quiet, and you can have a quiet spirit, but you don't have to be quiet and have a quiet spirit. Y'all following me?
Yeah.
But it's a peacefulness, it's a calmness, it's a settledness about you. And this is precious in the sight of the Lord. So when we look at beautiful ashes, we look at beauty. I mean, over the years, we missed the definition of beauty. You know, even in the church. I mean, people, we know how to dress up the part. We know how to look the part. We know how to carry ourselves away. And inwardly, we are dying. We are going through. Look at these pastors across the country that's committed suicide. Look at these marriages that are being destroyed. In the past, I would say, 5 years or 7 years or so. I mean, y'all bear with me because I believe in being real. Amen. In the past 5 or 6 years or so, I know my husband and I can count friends of ours. It's at least about 7 or 8 couples, pastors that are divorced. Are y'all hearing me?
Alright.
They have gotten divorced, have closed their church. And some, they left the wife, they kept the church. Amen. Yeah, that's a whole other subject. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16 says, therefore we do not lose heart, but though our outward man is decaying, yet our inward man is being renewed day by day.
Uh-huh.
You know, sometimes we lose heart. He said, but don't lose heart. But sometimes we're like, Lord, okay, I've been faithful, I've been serving, I've been giving, I've been sowing.
Uh-huh.
God, you got to come and you got to help me. You got to help me.
Yes.
You're going through. And he said, when we're going through, he said, we don't lose heart, but though our outward man is decaying, yet our inward man is being renewed day by day. Have you ever been through a trial or a test, and you felt like you were dying?
Uh-huh.
I mean, like, God, if you didn't come in and move, I'm not going to make it.
Right.
But do you not know in those moments, that's when you can cry out to God and say, God, help me.
Yes. Yes.
Help me through this, because if you can't call on God in your toughest time, why do you need God? Church, we worship. It's just not in here we give God the glory.
Well,
but when in at home, behind closed doors, we don't have an audience in front of us. We gotta learn how to give God the glory in those moments. Because at the end of the day, when you look at ashes, I'm gonna give you what ashes mean. The definition I found: it's the remains of something destroyed, ruins. In the Hebrew text, ashes represent a time of repentance and mourning. When people place them on their head and sat in sackcloth and ashes. It's the remains of something destroyed and ruined. Have anybody been there?
Mm-hmm.
When something has been destroyed in your life or ruined.
Yes.
When I look back at our spouse that have been divorced or separated or just gone through their marriage, have passed away, whatever the situation may be. You know, at the end of the day, when you look at your life, you can say, Lord, that could have been me. That could have been my marriage. That could have been my situation. Such was some of us. I mean, you can't look down on anybody. You can't put your nose up and act like you're better than them because if it wasn't for God bringing you through it, you would have made it either. But ashes are the remains of something destroyed or ruined. It's a time of repentance and mourning. And I want to look at the book of Esther. And I want to review, I'm going to give you the story. I'm not going to read the scripture, I'm going to give you the story. Because this is an awesome text to show you how they were in sackcloth and ashes because of their whole generation of people, culture, of people, the Jews, they were going to be destroyed. A man plotted against them, Haman. Y'all know the story. A man plotted against them, Haman, to destroy Esther's people. But Esther chapters 3-8, if you want to just write that down so you can go home and read it. Because let me tell you this, I read this text many times. But even as I was reviewing for this message, I said, oh my gosh. Lord, I've never seen this. They always talk about Esther, if I perish, I perish, I'm going to see the king, or however they always say it. But the story was so much bigger than it. And when you look at beauty for ashes, the story opens up in Esther chapter 3, when her uncle Mordecai had heard about Haman's plot against the Jews. He heard about it, and he put on sackcloth and ashes. He sat in sackcloth and ashes. And he was so upset, he cried out and said he went in the streets, and he cried out. He was crying because he knew that his people was going to be destroyed. The devil hated his people. So we see him crying out. And then Esther heard about her uncle crying out in the street in sackcloth and ashes. And she sent one of her servants to say, go take my uncle some clothes. Why does he have on sackcloth and ashes? She didn't know what was going on at that time. She didn't know what was going on. But he was crying out in the street because his people was about to be destroyed. The devil was plotting against his people. Uh-huh. Don't you know tonight, ladies, men, that the devil, he knows you. He's plotting against you.
Well,
he looks at you and he's saying, I'm going to destroy her.
Yes.
We read the scripture in John 10:10, that the thief coming not, but the thief kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you may have life, and that you may have it more abundantly. Amen. I think y'all for those sisters dance on tonight. Y'all did a great job. Amen. Bless y'all. Amen. Jesus said that he came. Still killing the shore. And look at Mordecai, a servant of the Lord, the leader in his community of the Jews. He put on sackcloth and ashes because the whole race of Jews is going to be wiped out because the devil hates them. So Esther, his niece, saw this and she said, go send him some clothes to change. He said, I'm not changing. And then she sent her servant to say, well, what's going on with you, uncle? Why are you in sackcloth and ashes? And he told her, he said, because there's a plot against us for our whole race of people, our whole culture of people to be destroyed.
Yeah.
And then she said, and he said, and she said, and she didn't know. And then she said, okay. She was like, but what do you want me to do? He said, well, I need you to go to the king because you don't want to save us. And couldn't it be that God put you in the kingdom, put you in the palace for this time? And she was like, yeah, maybe, but if I go in front of the king, I'm going to be killed. Because unless he summons you to come, you're going to be killed if you walk in there and he didn't tell you to come. Y'all think we go through with women. She was a queen and she could just go walk up on the king. They had separate houses. They had separate quarters. Y'all know that story? She couldn't even walk in the presence of the king without him holding out his scepter and say, come on. So she couldn't even just walk up in there like some of, you know, we do. Amen. Anyway, so she was like, okay, that may be true. I can die. Yeah. She was like, so I just can't walk in there and say, help us, because he could kill us.
Right.
Y'all follow me?
Yeah.
So Mordecai said, okay, but if you don't go to the king, don't think. If you keep silent, if you don't go talk to him, okay, because she was afraid of dying, and she went in his presence without being invited. She was like, well, he said, but you're going to die anyway, because if they try to kill the Jews, with you, and you're gonna die also. So she was like, you're right, I'm gonna die anyway. Y'all need to read the Bible when you read the Bible.
Yeah.
She said, I'm gonna die anyway. So she said, okay, listen, I want y'all to fast and pray. She had asked all the Jews to fast and pray for 3 days and three nights. No water or juice, no food. Amen. I know I'm gonna fast today. Just, yeah. No water or food for 3 days and three nights. And her, and she and her handmaid also fasted for 3 days and three nights. Because she was asking them to fast, because when I walk and go in front of the king, I want to be ready. So y'all fast and pray so I won't die. Amen? So people fast and pray. Long story short, she went in front of the king. He held out his scepter, and he allowed her to come in. And then she said, I want to talk to you about something. She invited him to a dinner. She had a feast of wine or something like that, banquet. And he came in. He said, okay, I'll come. And she wanted to invite Haman. Well, while that was going on, she invited Haman and the king to a dinner. While she was preparing for the dinner, the king could not sleep one night. Ahasuerus, he couldn't sleep one night. So he asked his servants to bring the chronicles of, I guess, what happened throughout the kingdom. Bring the book of the chronicles so I can review what happened in the kingdom. And as he read the chronicles, he found out that her uncle Mordecai had saved him. It was two eunuchs that was gonna assassinate him. And Mordecai came and he told the king the plan of these two eunuchs who guarded at the door. Woo! There's nothing new under the sun, is there? There's nothing new under the sun. Here it is, Mordecai, a Jew serving, saw the plot of the people in the king's palace trying to kill the king. But it was in the chronicles. It was written by the scribe. So as he was resting asleep one night, he asked to bring in the book. He read how Mordecai did this for him. Now mind you, the man Haman was the one who put some things in place to have these Jews destroyed. He had made a gallows at his house for Mordecai. Esther's honor be hung on these gallows. I hope I'm not going too fast. I don't want y'all to get this story. So hang on the gallows. So he read the chronicles and he said, oh my gosh, Mordecai is the man that saved my life because two eunuchs was trying to kill me. Yeah. And he saved me. He said, what did we do? He asked his servant, what did we do for this man who tried to save my life? What did we give him? They said, we know nothing that you gave the king. Get this, the king called Haman in.
Yes.
The one who fought against the Jew, he called Haman and said, this man who honored the king, Haman, what should I do for this man who honored me, who spared my life with two eunuchs taken? And Haman thought he was talking about him, the man that the king honored. He said, well, I would put him on a robe, I would parade him through the crowd, I would put a crown on him, I would go all out to please the king.
All right.
I would go all out so that people can know and recognize this man. And he was like, okay. He said, so I want you to go do this for Mordecai. Now mind you, Haman hated what? The Jews. He hated Mordecai. He had planned to have all the Jews murdered. So he ended up having Carrie, and let me go back to Haman's wife.
Yeah.
Have y'all read the story of Haman's wife? Oh my gosh. He would go and confide in his wife.
Yeah.
And the wife said, yeah, you need to kill the Jews. Let me tell y'all this. If your husband go off the left field, if he leaves God,
come on.
I'm not insulting men, I love men.
Amen.
We love men at the University City Church. Praise the Lord. So we love men, so I'm not trying to insult men. But I'm saying, so many times if your husband get off track,
yes,
or the wife get off track, you can't have that much love that you follow them. Both of y'all fall in a ditch. And you not know, she was like, okay, yeah, go ahead and do it. Yeah, you should do that. Yeah, you should kill them. Instead of saying, hold on, you better leave God's people alone.
All right.
So he wanted to kill the Jews, but he had to parade this Mordecai in the street with the robe, with the protecting the king. Why? Why? Let me move this story along.
That's good.
So he paraded through the streets. After that happened, y'all, listen to this. After that happened, he paraded through the streets. Mordecai went back there fasting, they're praying, they're seeking God. I gotta get back to the text, and I've lost my place. Y'all give me a minute. All right. So he told the king to, that Mordecai was really special because he thought the king was talking about him. When Haman found out the king was talking about honoring Mordecai, he became very upset. But he had to do all that he told the king, and then he had paraded in the street. Esther finally had an opportunity to sit down with the king. Let me say this. Even before Esther had an opportunity to talk to the king, look at God, I want y'all to follow this. Even before Esther had an opportunity to sit down with the king and tell him about Haman's plot against the Jews, God had already spoke to the king and showed him how to bless Mordecai. God was already moving on their behalf because he put himself in sackcloth and ashes. Amen? Because I don't want to miss this point. So God was blessing. As I read this text, I was like, God, you are already blessing the man of God.
Yes.
Before she even sat down and told the king what she wanted. So Mordecai walking the street, being paraded by Haman, the man wanted hanging on the gallows. After that, you all, Esther finally got to sit down with the king and Haman at the banquet. She got to sit down with the king and Haman, and she finally got to tell the king in front of Haman, King, I wanted to meet with you. She had to send me my husband. Praise the Lord. That's how it was in those days. Amen. Praise God. Why are you laughing? No, because I saw in this text, superintendent, the respect she had for her husband. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. And so she finally sat down with the king and Haman. And she told him, this man, she looked at him and said, this man is the one who's been plotting against my people. This man is the one who wanted to destroy and annihilate all the Jews. She sat down and she told him, but mind you, he was already, God was already moved for them when he ended up having the king bless Mordecai. So she said that. And then the king said, really? He said, you have half of the kingdom. I give you half of the kingdom. Whatever you want me to do, it's going to be done. That's what she said. And that's what the king said. Then the king said, this man was fighting against your people. Yes, he was. Then he told her, guess what? Haman, at this time, I want you to be taken. He had his servant take Haman to his house, to the gallows, where he was going to hang Mordecai, and he got hung. Right. Amen? He got hung. After that, Esther went back and told Ahasuerus that Mordecai was her uncle. Not until that time, now, he didn't even know she was a Jew. He hadn't even told the king that she was a Jew. She said, Mordecai is my uncle. I gotta read this. Esther chapter 8, verse 15 and 7. I'm gonna read this quickly. So Mordecai went out from the presence of the king. After she told him that he was a Jew, the king gave Esther rule over Haman's house. She gave Esther all of Haman's house. Are y'all following me?
Yes.
Now where did the story start? I know it's late and I know it because it's unfold, but I want to give y'all something that you can take home and remember. When you're in ashes and when it seems like you're hopeless and the devil's trying to tear you down, God is already moving on your behalf.
Yes.
So you saw it out in ashes, in sackcloth and ashes, crying in the street. This is Mordecai for his people because they were going to be annihilated. Now we see God allowed the enemy to parade this man of God in the streets in royal robe and royal and the crown on his head.
Yeah.
Now we see the man who wanted to kill all the Jews being hung on his own gallows at his home.
Uh-huh.
After that, it says God gave Esther all of Haman's house. She received control of all of Haman's house. Not only that, but she appointed her uncle Mordecai over the entire house. And going back to the text, chapter 8, verse 15 and 17 says, so Mordecai went out from the presence of the king in royal and in apparel of blue and white with a great crown of gold and a garment of fine linen and purple. And the city of Shoshan rejoiced and was glad. Then many people of the land became Jews. Y'all hear that?
Yeah. Right.
Then many people of the land became Jews because the fear of the Jews fell upon them. Wow.
I just want y'all to meditate on that.
Wow.
Here we have Mordecai. Our text is Beauty for Ashes. Subtitled, Waiting on God While You Are Going Through. You have Mordecai in the text, sitting in sackcloth and ashes, crying because his people's about to be annihilated. When you look at your generation, when you look at your family, when you look at where you come from, what pattern do you see of going through and people being destroyed, whether alcoholism, drug addiction, sexual addiction, in prison? What pattern do you see in your family? What have you gone through as a child? And the devil said, you're not going to come out of this. The next generation's not going to make it through because I had a grip on them all these years. When I look at the story of Mordecai, I see that. Because some of us, the devil is trying to take our families out. He's trying to destroy our families. So I know this was a lengthy story I told, but I want you to get the gist of this. This was in the Bible. Let's look at our own. Let's make it relevant to the day. This man was going through. He was crying out for his family. But at the end of the story, he up in royal regal attire. Yes. God took the ashes he had and God gave him beauty. Yes. This man was short and his blue and his white. Yes. He became a ruler over his enemy's house.
Yes.
Where you are today, when we talk about beauty for ashes, you can dress it up. We can dress up all we want to on the outside. But what if the devil been plaguing you with the sin, what you're not gonna come out of and what you're not gonna be? Yourself in a place where he can do it in your life.
Yes.
Be faithful. doors of the church are open. You're here. You're serving. You're in place. You're doing what you need to do for God. Because as you serve and do it unto God, He will bless your life.
Yes.
He will bless your life. Serve and give your time, your talents, your treasures. The Lord will bless you. But He don't want you sitting around having a pity party. Because guess what? What your story is, the person sitting next to you, and maybe they're shouting and dancing and hollering, and you saying they need to sit down. Their story may be worse off than yours.
Yes.
But they realize in a praise and giving God the glory.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I make it through. I get through.
Yes.
He blesses me to get through. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Isn't the will of God for Christians to suffer? Have any of y'all asked that question? Is the will of God for Christians to suffer? I ain't heard some no's, yes. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12 says in the NIV version, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted.
Amen.
Everyone who wants to live a godly life will be persecuted. When you say yes to Jesus, guess what? You're going to be persecuted. I mean, my 13-year-old daughter come home from school, the first week of school, she's telling me she loved the school last year. And then she was middle school, then she came home crying and saying, Mom, I want to go to another school. Can you homeschool me? And they prayed. I'm like, no, it's too late for that. And that's what's wrong. She's because these girls, a friend of hers, come and tell her what other girls in another group are talking about her. And I told her, I said, if you don't learn how to deal with that now as a child, you'll be a grown woman. Still running from people talking about you. But you gotta deal with this. And the girl is coming to speak in your ear about this foolishness. You're gonna tell her, you're not gonna talk to me and tell what other people said about me, because that's not a friend. Hello? That's not a friend. Well, she followed my advice. Now you have class with these girls. None of them in my class, none of them. Okay. She followed my advice, and guess what? The girl don't speak in her ear, she's at peace. Amen?
Amen.
She's at peace. Made the volleyball team, praise God.
Amen.
I said the volleyball team knows that God has already elevated. Glory. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I let me tell you this. You're going to be persecuted at whatever level. And if you don't deal with it, if you don't see God, and you don't allow the Lord to take you through those moments, when you're going through your ass, you feel like you've been burnt up, burnt down, you're going to struggle as a child, you're going to struggle as an adult.
Yes.
So you can't run from the enemy. Then Mordecai run from this enemy?
No.
When Mordecai was standing in the court of the king, Haman would walk through, and he was so mad because Mordecai did not stand up and honor Haman. He was mad, y'all, because he did not stand up to this evil man. He did not stand up to respect him. That's why he hated him. Who are you standing up to, and you know they hate you? And now, I'm not saying leadership, praise God, and glory, but I'm just saying, give honor who honor is due. So I'm not saying sit there and look crazy and you know, so I walk through the room and they're in a position of authority. You're a boss and other people, you get fired. Amen. You need to honor, give honor to who honor is due. But I'm saying, who is that person that really don't matter in your life? You allow them to control you. You allow them to speak negativity in your ear. You allow them to put you through changes. And they have no significance in your future. Yeah, they may be losers. Really?
All right.
Everybody's God's child. Let me tell you this. The devil will use people.
Yes.
He's a real enemy. But guess what? Don't let anybody yoke you up, put you in a box, have you afraid to go here and go there because you fear this.
Amen.
And have you back. I don't know why I'm saying that, but it's for somebody. Amen?
Amen.
But we must learn to wait on God in the midst of the suffering with prayer, fasting, and listening and talking to God in counsel about what we're going through. Proverbs 11:14 says, where no counsel is, the people follow. In the multitude of counsels, there is safety.
Yes.
There is safety. Esther didn't just go to the king on her own. She had an uncle to encourage her, people behind her, to pray with her, to do what she needed to do to save her people. Who are you talking to? Who is your counsel? Are they godly? Or they just tell you to keep running your mouth, gossiping about people, talking about the problem, not the solution? Are they making you better? Are they making you bitter? and you're bitter.
Yes.
You got to let God heal you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
You got to let God heal your heart. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory
yes.
to God. Just
yes.
now set your feet in your name.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Thank you,
Jesus. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 28 through verse 31 says, "Has thou not known, has thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no search of his understanding. He giveth power to the faint."
Yes.
We feel like fainting and giving up. God gives power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increases strength. Some of you all tonight, you have no might. You're like, "God, I'm just a shell. I'm here. And if you don't help me, I've been there. Anybody else been there?
Yes.
And after God, if you don't come in and move and touch me, I'm not going to make it. Any of y'all been there?
Yes.
Serving the Lord? And guess what? He comes in and he touches you.
Yes, he does.
He strengthens you. But you got to be real.
Yes.
Listen, this, the Bible says, the day every man's work is going to be tried by fire.
Yes.
And the day is going to declare it. Let me tell you, this is the day. It's going to be declared. It's going to be tested by fire to see what kind of work you have. So just to have a front. Amen. God wants to make you beautiful. And it's not just the outside, but it's on the inside. The bitterness, the hurt, the anger, in the church. You should be in the church for years and get ugly and nasty and more mean. You should be nice. Come to church and you mean and nasty.
Yes.
People come in, you're hurt, and you ask them, "Why are you here? Church don't go that way."
Right.
Oh, yeah, we've had to set some people down over the years. Amen.
Amen.
Church don't go that way.
Amen.
And you're here, you know what? Because you got caught up in doing church, but you forgot the God who saved you.
Yeah.
And his work is supposed to be doing.
Right.
You forgot the God that called you out of darkness into his light. Church work, that you can get the God that you're working on.
All right,
now. And so he gives power to the faint, and them that have no might, he increases strength. Anybody want to increase the strength tonight?
Yes.
It says, even the youth shall faint and be weary.
Yes.
Even the young people. And the young men shall utterly fall without God holding you up. But they that wait upon the Lord
yes.
shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Now we have to wait on God.
Yes.
Wait on God while you are going through.
Yes.
Beauty for ashes. Everything may look like it's burnt up, but God has you.
Yes.
God has you. Yes. If you still live, you have breath in your body. God has you.
Amen.
God is holding you up.
Yes.
What you should be saying is, "God, so if I'm still living, what do you want me to do?
Yes.
What do you call me to do?"
Yes.
I went through a phase in my life. I've been a born again Christian 32 years this past August. 32 years. And I got to a point in my walk, loving God, saving, I'm like, "God, everything I pray for you to do, you've done in my life. I need fresh vision."
Amen.
I need fresh vision because some of us, God has done what we've asked, but now we're just going through the motion. Like I said, "God, you got to give me fresh vision. You got to revive me. You got to refresh me. You got to strengthen me, God. I love you, but I can't occupy time with me. I got some years to live. Amen. I have some years to live. I need fresh vision." And guess what? That's how I ended up going back to school, working on my master's degree. Amen. Got one more class. Glory. Working on my master's degree. Administration marketing. I did that. That was not something I wanted to do all the rest of my life. So I was like, "God, you got to give me fresh vision." And I went back to school because it was better, made me more effective at serving the people of God in ministry. That's why I did it. Not having time of being more effective at serving God's people, the practical as well as the spiritual. People are so wounded in the church. You're hurt and the ashes, you've been burnt down, but you didn't allow God to build you up. And you cannot serve God effectively if you're wounded. You cannot go forth and serve and love if you won't be the compliant, humble, tame, and unresisting.
Yeah.
It's not about going through the motions. It's about being real. God, heal me.
Yes.
God, help me.
Yes.
God, strengthen me.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, God.
As I close with this statement, Matthew Henry said, "Neither the mercy of God, nor the atonement of Christ, nor the gospel of grace, prophets the self-sufficient and the proud." Let me read that again. again, Matthew Henry, commentator, says neither the mercy of God, the atonement of Christ, nor the gospel of grace promises the self-sufficient and the proud. I said earlier, why some people are so blessed and others, what about humility? What about humbleness? What about remembering where God brought you out of and not being afraid to tell your story? Amen?
Yes.
I know I know what I know about the grace of God. Yes. I don't let people make me feel like God has blessed my life. God has done this. God has given me more than I asked, think, or imagine. He's done more than me to ask for. He had to add to it. Amen. He's added to it. And that's not arrogance. That's like, God, you've done it. I mean, a single parent home. My mom got divorced when I was three. Amen. I saw her abused. My dad came in beating her drunk. I saw it coming up. And with a temper revival, God came in my community. Pastor Wood and Pastor Turner, they came in my community. And I heard about Jesus. I said, that's what I've been looking for. Because if you don't, I wanted hope. And I'm like, I know it's more than this. My God. I don't want to grow up. And if you did it, that's okay. God, grace, God saved you, God, and then you move forward. But that's all I saw. And I'm like, God, I want to be saved. I saw abuse. I saw me and my family going to prison. All of that. And I said, God, if you're real, I want you to save me. My mom was the first one to get saved and hit that temper revival. I'm talking about ashes. And going through now, and let me tell you this, and I shared this with someone the other day. As Job said, he said, the thing that I feared most came upon me. And I guess he feared his kids being dead, and God took everything. My God, all of his, what, seven kids died? And then his wife said, curse me that, Lord, no. Let me tell you, the Bible says, a woman can bring a man to a piece of bread, a woman have power, and only act like we don't have no control. Yes, we do. Look at how women enforce their husband. She wants you to just curse God and die. Look at Haman, Job's wife. Wow, Lord, help us women.
Amen.
And, but I look at that story, the thing fear came upon me. Even as a Christian, there were things that occurred in my marriage, with my kids, in my home. And the thing that I feared came upon me. And the Lord, Holy Spirit, said, you didn't die, bitch. You still living? I'm still Lord. I said, yeah.
Jesus.
But I said, God, I mean, I'm a Christian. I should be going through this. The thing I feared came upon me, when it came upon me, oh my God, I was more fortified. I was more strong because I said, oh my God, Father, in you I live and move and have my being. You are Lord, besides you, there is no other.
Yes.
My God, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live a life of Christ that lives in me. He showed me his power. He showed me his glory.
Yes.
That it's not. Thank God for a man that loves me, love God, but it's not. That don't make me who I am. I am what I am by the grace of God.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. And when you know who you are by the grace of God, you can be a good wife, you can be a good mother, because you don't need anybody to make you who you are.
That's right.
Because God will have no other God before him. So sometimes while the ashes, who do you have as God before him? What do you have to burn down for you to see? Let's be real.
My God.
Let's be real. What did he have to take away from you for you to see him? Let's be real. I've had friends of mine who said, husband played for the NFL. They said, when he played, I couldn't even see God. When he played, I was so into him, and God showed me, I worship you, worship your husband.
Sister Mary, that was today.
I hate to hear that. Jesus, but God showed me I was worshiping my husband. Wow. But what have you been doing that you know God burned it down? You went through it because you know you made it to God. You know you went through it because, and let me tell you this, some things I've gone through, and I talked to my older sister, and I know I'm telling y'all too much, but hey, this is how I was.
Amen.
But I told my older sister, I said, I know some of the things I've been through in life, marriage, personal. I know you just laughed and said, how is she going through? Yeah, she needs to go through. She said, I never felt that way. I'm like, well, this is one way I followed when we were growing up, teenagers, all the time. But now she's my buddy. And I said, I knew you were like, I'm glad she's going through that. She said, no, I never thought that. But in myself, I was like, God, ooh, you know how to break somebody down.
Yes.
So I can hear you and know that you are Lord, and beside you there is no other. Because before I met my husband, before I met this person, that person, before there was a university church, I knew God. And because I know God, that can't define me. He's Lord. He's God. And unless we make him Lord in our lives, we're going to miss it. We're going to miss it. Because we're not making him Lord. So sometimes, why the ashes? Have you, even since you've gone through the ashes, have you really surrendered all to God? I want to pray. Have you really said, God, I give everything, I give my all to you? Because let me tell you this. Since they really, have y'all looked and read, looked at the news and seen what's going on in the world? You can't play church. You can't act like you have power. You shake yourself and there's nothing there. My God, you can't play church. Listen, no matter where you come from, broken home together, mama, daddy, they are wonderful. Because it took me a while to realize everybody's growing with mine.
All right.
Everybody's got a broken home. Amen. Everybody's growing with mine. Praise God for it. Everybody has a story. Everybody has a story. And my thing is, are you sharing your story? Or are you trying to hide the ashes that you've gone through? Because what you've gone through can be an encouragement and a blessing to strengthen somebody else.
Yes.
When you are converted, and the Bible says, strengthen your brother. Who are you strengthening? Are you still having a pity party? Are you still making excuses for not being what God wants you to be? Who are you touching? Who are you impacting for God's glory?